So welcome to Planning Your Open Atrium site. This is a webinar for organizations to learn about planning an Open Atrium instance for your organization. I have with me today Annie Stone from Phase 2, and she is going to be monitoring the question queue. So please feel free to add your questions to the queue, and then I will pause throughout the conversation to wait for some questions, and Annie will help me with those. So thank you, Annie, for helping us out, and we'll go ahead and get started. My name is Karen Borchard. I'm the VP of Strategic Initiatives here at Phase 2, and we are the key maintainers of Open Atrium, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. So for those of you who may not know or who are not familiar with Open Atrium, Open Atrium is open source collaboration software that is used to build intranets, portals, and collaboration platforms for organizations. It has a lot of features, including all kinds of collaboration features that you would use, like documents and events and discussions, as well as the ability to provide multimedia, track tasks, and do a lot of really powerful things with data security, identity management, and so forth. You can learn a lot more about all of the features at openatrium.com, but Open Atrium is a robust platform used to build collaboration tools for organizations. To use it, Open Atrium is an open source distribution of the Drupal code base. It is free to download to anyone. You can download it at drupal.org project Open Atrium. But installing the code from Drupal does require some technical knowledge and an understanding of Drupal. So less technical teams or people who just want to test it out or try it can try out Open Atrium in a hosted environment, like on Pantheon. And you can look at that right at getpantheon.com, or if you go to openatrium.com, there's a button that'll take you right to a one-click install. And a developer team like Phase 2 or a lot of other organizations can help you customize it if you'd like. So Open Atrium is completely free, completely open source, and has no licenses or per-seat fees like some other collaboration tools do. So it can be an incredibly flexible solution, and you can really spend your time and energy on customizing it for your organization rather than paying for fees and seats. So how can you use it? There's a number of use cases, a number of ways that people can use Open Atrium. These are just a few examples. You can create an intranet, such as a corporate intranet, and we're going to look at this example a little bit more depth soon. But this is a case where you might have documents, events, discussions, and multimedia. You might have the ability for people to access this on their mobile device and keep data that is private to some groups and organizations and public to others. You can also create a social collaboration platform. So this is an example of a platform that you might use to connect the citizens of a community together to share ideas, connect with their elected officials, and have ideas for how to improve their city. So again, this has the ability for citizens to connect with discussions. You can create custom dashboards here, have videos and multimedia, an events calendar, activity streams, notifications, and also social tools. You can use Open Atrium for a knowledge management system. We actually use Open Atrium for all of the, to store and publish all of the documentation for Open Atrium for the product itself, which is at docs.openatrium.com. And you can see here that there is robust document management. We also have videos and multimedia. You can access this on your mobile device. And then you can actually also create within that knowledge management system data privacy and identity management to allow certain people to access different pieces, as well as workflow and some robust tags and taxonomies. You can also use Open Atrium for a learning management system, to store course documents, have recorded lectures, have a course calendar, and be able to provide online learning tools for users, and that could be in an education environment, but it also could be in a corporate training environment or an organizational learning capacity. And you can create a web portal. So Open Atrium allows you to create collaboration tools that are not just internal or privately facing sites, but you can also create publicly facing sites. Open Atrium has the ability to create sort of a microsite concept where you could have microsites for each of your different missions or projects all over the world, and engage members and or donors or customers at different areas through a web portal. And you can engage them in very, very public information or in private discussions either way. So when people start using Open Atrium, there's a little bit of a question about really how do you get started? Open Atrium is platform-based. It doesn't just fulfill, as you see here, it doesn't just fulfill one need. There's actually a lot of opportunities for using Open Atrium. And so you want to find a way to start with Open Atrium that will be the best plan for your organization, and for the exact need that you have. So it can be a little bit confusing. You just open up Open Atrium, you download it, or you spin it up on Pantheon, and all of a sudden you say, oh, okay, you have kind of a blank canvas and it's hard to know where to start. And that's what this webinar is really all about. So we're going to talk through the building blocks of Open Atrium 2 today. We're going to talk about them in some detail. And then I'm going to kind of show you exactly how one might do that when you're creating an intranet, and then give you some thoughts on some things that you want to be careful of and some red flags to avoid. So we're going to start with the Open Atrium building blocks. And this content is all available as well on our documentation site. Open Atrium, as we said, has kind of four main areas of building blocks: people, structure, permissions, and content. We're going to go through each one. So let's start with people. So in Open Atrium, there are members, and a member is anybody with access to your site. So anybody with access to your Open Atrium site, and that can be all of your employees or all of your team members. A group in Open Atrium is a collection of users that spans a related purpose across multiple spaces. So a group could relate to a function, a role. So you might have a group for your executive team or a group for your board of directors. Or it could be for a specific geography. You could have a group of people in your Western region or your Eastern region. Or you could have a group that has a really specific purpose or a specific need, like your HR department. A team is an ad hoc collection of users, and they're specific to one space. So if you think of a team as like a task force or a committee, you say, okay, I'm going to create a task force to write a new policy for our organization, and I need a person from our HR department, and I need somebody from our finance department, and I need somebody, one of our executives, and they're going to get together and write this new policy. And those three people together create this ad hoc little team that can accomplish something specific. So that's the people concept: members, groups, and teams. And now I promise we're going to go over this a lot of times. So you don't memorize all of this right now, but members, groups, and teams. The next thing that we talk about is structure. And the best way that we like to think about structure in terms of Open Atrium is like a file cabinet. If everybody's ever seen a cabinet that where you store all of your documents and things, a big file cabinet, think of it that way. So the first concept is a space. A space is really simply a collection of content. So think of a space like a filing cabinet, just one great big filing cabinet, and it's filled with drawers and folders and information. So it's a collection of content. A subspace is an additional division of content within a space, like the drawer of a filing cabinet. But really, a subspace is just a space nested within another space. So it's just, it's also a collection of content, just like a space is. It's just nested inside of another space. And you can nest as many subspaces as you want in Open Atrium. A section is just like you could have as many drawers as you want in a file cabinet. You can have as many subspaces as you want. In a section, that's where your content actually lives on your site. So it's like a file folder in your drawer. So if you have a file folder, and it's in your file cabinet drawer, and that's in your file cabinet, That's where the actual information is. And we're going to see how that all fits together in just a minute. So that's the structure. So we now have people and we have structure. And now we have permission. So what's really exciting about Open Atrium is its permission and data privacy controls. So the ability to create spaces and sections that are public, where any registered user could see it, or private, where only specific members of that space can access that content, or mixed mode, where you have a top level space that's public, and then there are private areas beneath it. So all three of these things can be used throughout your Open Atrium site, but this is an important building block because you'll want to think about how you're going to expose information and give people the access that they need without overwhelming them with too much information too. So people, content, permissions, or I'm sorry, people, structure, permissions, and then now content. So Open Atrium ships with a couple of types of content right out of the box. There's documents that you can use for document pages, wiki pages, articles, document management. There's events. So you can integrate with iCal. You can, create events and list them in different ways. Discussions. So for forums and discussions, idea, a suggestion box, different ideas, different ways to have discussions on your site. And then work tracker, which allows you to monitor projects and milestones and deliverables throughout. So there's these kind of four main areas of content. You can customize Open Atrium and add your own content types as well, but these are the ones that it comes with. So people, structure, permissions, content. I'm going to pause for a second and see if Annie has any questions from the field here. And I might need to... Annie, do you have the ability to unmute yourself?
Yes, okay. I do, and we do have a question.
Okay.
Our question is, are there steps for using LDAP for the people authentication and group definition? I assume there are additional modules that would need to be added. Finally, has the critical issue been addressed where the site breaks if a new module is installed?
Yes, okay. Good questions. Real quick, yes, there is LDAP integration out of the box in Open Atrium. And yes, we just rolled a new release this morning that fixed the critical issues. There are still some challenges on Drupal.org, but if you go to the Open Atrium project site on Drupal.org, there's a very large link at the very top of the site that says this is where to get the newest release. And that critical issue is fixed. So I'm going to move on. So people, structure, permissions, and content. We're going to now put them all together. So we're going to talk about a little case study. We're going to look at a company that takes the building blocks of Open Atrium to create an intranet that meets their content creation, asset storage, collaboration, security needs. So you remember we looked at people, right? So the members in this case are employees, registered users of the Acme company intranet. And then we created a couple of groups. We created an executives group. So the leadership team has access to multiple spaces. And we created a group for the HR department because they have some specific needs and they'll also have access to multiple spaces. And then we also created a team called policy writers. That was sort of what I was talking about before. They're writing a new policy in a restricted section. And together, we'll look at all of these members and how they interact with their content. So remember our filing cabinet, and this is how this works. So the file cabinet is turned sideways, so you can see what's inside. And this is the space, the file cabinet, for Acme's human relations department, so their HR department. And that space has public and private permissions. So the top level is open and public, but there are restricted areas within it, as you can see. So the very bottom most drawer, that subspace, is called employee resources. And in it are several sections. Those sections include a benefits discussion forum and an employee benefits document area and a company policies document area. And within each of those folders, within each of those sections, that's where that content lives. So those discussions, events, pages, documents all live in those specific and organized sections. Now there's another subspace called the HR workspace that is a little bit more closed off. There's a new policy feedback forum that is open, but then there are two locked sections for the HR department to work in. Those are areas for working on people's salary information and where you'll have sensitive data that you only want your HR department to see. And you have a section for new policies where that team, if you remember that policy writing team, is working on drafting a new policy. So that section is also private, so that employees don't have access to that policy until it's made an official policy in the company. And then you have a subspace at the top for employee contracts that's completely private, and it's locked off to the executives in the HR department alone. And that's where you would have the very sensitive information around people's employee contracts. So this is one space and the sections, subspaces and sections within it for a department. You could have a space or a subspace that is much more robust and has a lot more information in it than this. You could also have one that is much less robust and that has, maybe just one space with a couple of sections in it. That's a completely great way to use Open Atrium as well. So this is just to start to get you understanding how spaces, subspaces, and sections work together for content and how members and groups and teams work together for people. So this is how all the building blocks of Open Atrium really fit together. So if you want to find this diagram and study it and learn it and think about it and put it under your pillow and memorize it, you can find it on the Open Atrium Docs site. It's at docs.openatrium.com, and that this is there in its entirety and can be a really helpful tool for teaching the rest of your organization how to think about Open Atrium and for you planning your site. So how do you translate that for your use? That's the next question. It's a really important one. But before I go on to it, I'm going to ask Annie if there are any more questions, I think specifically about the building blocks. Are there questions there? And if there's questions generally about Open Atrium, we'll save them to the end. But any questions about that section?
We do have a question. Can a member be in multiple groups and also on teams? And are there any restrictions there?
Great question. A member can definitely be a member of several groups. And that is that they are generally expected that they'll be a member of several groups. So and there are no restrictions on how many groups you can be a part of or anything like that. So that is, and the same goes for teams. You can create as many ad hoc teams as you want, and people can be on as many teams as they need to be on. Great question. So how do we translate this for your use? This is the most important thing you need to know. There is no single right way to do this. Your Open Atrium site can be set up in a lot of different ways, and a lot of different ways can be really good for you. It's a matter of seeing what works best for your organization, and I'm not going to give you a perfect format for exactly how to organize your site, because you have to do it according to your needs as an organization. But I'll walk you through how to think about it. So a couple of golden rules. We have a few thou shall nots. And these are the things that, you can do these things if you want to, but we don't recommend them as best practice with Open Atrium. So when you're thinking about how your site all fits together, these are the things you want to really try to avoid. Thou shall not create identical content multiple times. You don't want to be creating a document or putting a document and then copying it and putting it in several different spaces and places throughout your site. When you have duplicate content, you have a red flag. You don't want to resend the same message or the same post to multiple places just so that you can get it to the right people. If you are having to repost content or repost a message or a communication, you may not have your site set up correctly. You don't want to ask users to sift through irrelevant content. So while you can have people to be members of a lot of different groups and a lot of different teams, you don't want them to log into Open Atrium and onto your site and see a whole bunch of stuff that doesn't pertain to them. So you want to try to avoid that. You do not want to have to move content to a different place in order to get approval. This is the workflow piece. If everybody who's involved with approving content for publishing is not on that same space or is not in the same place, and you have to move content out of a space just to get it approved, we may not have things set up quite right. And then finally, you don't want to have people storing or posting things in the wrong places. You need to have people posting things where you need to have them posting things, which makes a lot of sense. So these are kind of the things that, you know, as you're thinking about, all right, what do I want for a space for this, or where do I want to put this? Think about these things. Try to avoid things like duplicate content and irrelevant content and, you know, workflow issues and that kind of thing in order to get things kind of in the right place. So a great Atrium site setup will do the following. It'll make it really easy for users to find content by having enough divisions to keep it organized. It'll make it easy for users to put content in the right places by not having so many divisions in so many places that it's confusing or duplicative. It reduces irrelevant content for users by setting memberships and permissions appropriately. And it keeps sensitive content private without limiting the public content. So these are the kind of hallmarks of a great site setup. There's three ways to not go crazy when you're working on this. They are delegate, iterate, and prototype. So I'm going to explain each one. Delegate. Do not ask a room of 15 people what they think the spaces of your Open Atrium site should be. Choose a couple of people to gather input and then sit down and work through it and make a decision or make a plan for it. A big group think around planning an Open Atrium site can be a pretty frustrating experience because, like I said, there's no exact one right way. So you might have 10 people with 10 different ideas and they all might be workable. What you really need is a couple of people to sit down and make a decision that's best for your organization. The second is iterate. Set this up and set up a plan for how you think your spaces and sections and groups and teams should be organized, and then test it out. Add some content and see what it looks like when you're logged in and how people can find content, and then repeat. Go back and make changes to the structure of your site and make plans for it. And that kind of brings me to the next piece, which is, you know, prototype this. So, you know, whether you do this on whiteboards or on paper or in actual file folders, can be your really helpful tools here. If you want to be in Open Atrium and practicing out and trying out in the actual tool, no problem. We just recommend in the admin turning on the sandbox mode. The sandbox mode will allow you to try it all out and practice it and then wipe the whole thing clean and start fresh if you want to. So do recommend using sandbox mode. If you try to just jump in and start creating spaces and sections and you're not in sandbox mode and then you decide later, oh, that's not working and I need to change the way I'm doing this, it can be difficult to go back and make all of those different changes to who's a member of these spaces and what those groups are and what those users are. So really recommend really planning it out first and or using sandbox mode. So let's do this. Let's give it a try. Before I do that, in terms of best practices, any questions on those kind of best practices for planning the site? Annie, any questions over in the field there?
We have quite a few questions. So, okay. I might say a few of them and maybe keep some for the end.
Okay, that sounds good.
Is there a way to group multiple pages into a single printable or PDF document?
Not at this time, I don't believe so.
Okay, next question is it possible to make one section visible for one group of registered users, but edit only for two users of this group?
Oh.
But editable only for two users of this group.
The question is whether you can make a section visible for some registered users, but only allow a couple of those users to actually edit. Absolutely. So Open Atrium has roles within it as well for any user, and any user out of the box can be an administrator, an editor, or a user. So a user can only view content and just view content. an editor can create content, an administrator can also then create spaces and sections and things. So yes, you would just want to have the members of that space, only two of them would be editors, and then the rest would just be viewers.
Okay, and then just one more question. How do you post content that is relevant to multiple groups?
How do you post content that is relevant to multiple groups? So depending on how the question is how to post content to multiple groups, and what you would do is you would just create a space like for corporate communications or all organization notifications or something like that, where you would invite multiple groups to be members of that space, or you would make it a completely public space where anybody could see it if you want, or you could have it just for specific groups, and you would have, and you would use a space for that function. So you would say, okay, we're gonna have this space that is corporate communications, and it's going to be available to everybody who's a member of the following, you know, five groups, and you post information there that all of those groups could see. So a space does not have a corollary to have any specific number of groups that can be members of it. So you can create a global space or a space with, you know, a few groups that are member that are subscribed to that space, or you can have it be really, really specific. So let's take a look, and that this may help, you know, help you kind of see it as well. So let's build an intranet. We're going to take the fictional case of the Greystone Coffee Purveyor national chain of coffee shops, and take a look at their corporate intranet for them and how to plan it. So this is a corporation with multiple regions and stores. Again, this is a fictional example. And they have a strong need for corporate headquarters to store communications, and corporate to store assets. So, you know, making sure everybody has all the best practices for how to make the right cup of coffee and things like that. And then they also have store-specific and region-specific communications around store openings and events and quality control and best practices. So they're looking for an intranet in order to achieve those kind of main goals. So the first thing that we recommend is looking a little bit at who, what, why. And this will really help you identify your users and your spaces and sections. And so you can do this really simply in this concept of who will use it, to do what, for what reason. So let's look at, you can do this on a piece of paper with a group of people, however you want. You say, okay, we have employees, like all employees of Greystone. We want them to read a weekly CEO communication in order to better understand corporate priorities. So that's one of the goals. One of the goals of the site is to get people to understand corporate priorities better. This is one way they can do it. We want the top scoring store managers from each region from their quality control audit to participate in a quality control task force in order to provide input into a better audit system. And you can kind of continue along on these things. You identify users that have a specific thing to do on this site and for what reason. And you don't want, you want to eliminate any that, you know, this is not where they're going to do this. They're going to do this in a different place, or they do this in a different way. You want to focus this on what people are going to use this Open Atrium site to do. And hey, look, there are some users and groups. You start to see, you've got users that are employees, and then you might have some groups around regional marketing manager or corporate HQ. And you start to see some spaces and sections. You see here, kind of this publish information on store openings and events. That may be a really great events calendar section. Or you see a discuss local staff concerns. That's a discussion section. So once you start to really see who's going to use it and what they're going to do and what goals for your site they're going to achieve here, you can really start to see it come together you can start to see your users and groups and spaces and sections emerge. So this is an exercise we really highly recommend people do. So in this case, here's how we did it. And I'm going to bring you back to our people, to our building blocks. So in this case, we said we went through all of those, and then we said, all right, so who are our members? Our members are all employees of the corporation. And then we're going to create some groups. We're going to create a group for local store managers, regional marketing managers, headquarters employees, and the executive team. And then we're going to create some, by what we needed people to do and work on, we're going to create a couple of teams. We're going to create a store opening committee for each region, and we're going to create an HR policy task force to write that new policy we keep talking about. And we're going to create a quality control task force to work on that quality control and audit idea that we have. So that you can start to see your members, your groups, and your teams emerge here. You can also start to see your structure emerge. So you say, okay, here's what I've got. I've got, you know, these four regions, and then I've got corporate headquarters. And this is a great example of what you know, the question about, you know, could we create a place where multiple people can see that content? You can create kind of a corporate communications space here that has news and a suggestion box and, you know, access to quality control information that people from all of these different regions can see. And then people would also be a member of their own region and potentially their own store. So in this case, you see this top line are the spaces. And then we've created beneath it some subspaces. And then we've created the sections. And again, you can see those sections is where your content actually lives. So that's where we see our events calendar, documents, staff discussions, news and information, and things like that. So you could certainly say, you know, I don't really think our store, you know, our stores need their own spaces. And you could eliminate the subspace of the stores if you don't feel like your store team members need a place to collaborate. If you think, you know, we'll be fine if we just have one space for the North region, for, you know, for each region. This is, again, the iterative process here. You may plan this out and see the hierarchy and think, oh, that's, you know, I don't know that we really need that level of granularity, and you may pull something out, or you may say, I think we need to have this distinguished even further and add another layer. And both of those things are okay. This is just an example. This is just one way to do this. You could do this exact same company's intranet in a completely different way if you wanted to. And then you look at permissions. So that's that next building block. You say, okay, that's, you know, there are going to be things like the news section or the suggestion box that are public. Any employee of the company can, you know, add a suggestion to the suggestion box or read the news about the company. But there may be things that are like the audit documents that are the documents from each store's audit that the audit team and the quality control team is keeping. That's going to be kept really private because that's pretty sensitive information. So again, these sites, you know, you can then start to apply your permissions to the structure that you've created and see if it makes sense to you. And again, at each of these turns, you want to be asking, does this make sense and does this feel right for our company and what we need it for? And then if you want to try it out in Open Atrium, you want to try to go ahead and get in there and build some stuff, you can. So this is the add content page in Open Atrium. It's just, you find it by seeing that little top left hand there. It says admin. You click on admin and go to content and add content, and you can add any of these things. So you can see here, you can add your group or your space or your section or your team. Any of those things can be added right here. If you don't know how to really actually go about creating these things in Open Atrium, that'll be a different webinar. That's one thing I should say. But you also can learn about it through the tours available. So if you hit the little question mark that's up in your screen when you are in Open Atrium, there are a number of tours that will take you on a full tour of a stop-by-stop tour of all of the areas of Open Atrium. And they'll also actually show you how to create a space, how to create a section, how to create users, how to create groups, how to create teams. And they will literally walk you to each piece of Open Atrium and let you do that along the way. So super powerful question mark button on any Open Atrium instance. It comes standard. So once you have your Open Atrium site going and set up, once you install it, you can just hit the question mark and take a full tour or get tutorials on any of these things. So all of these things, once you know what your structure is, there's a lot of education in the tool for how to do it. There's also a lot of documentation at the docs site to help you do that as well. So that's one way we could set up the site. That's how we apply our building blocks to this concept. Before I move on to the important question of did I do it right, do we have any more questions about how I did that in terms of that specific instance or about how you would apply the building blocks?
We have lots of questions. I'll just repeat a couple. Does the search feature work across spaces as well as for a specific space or section?
That depends a little bit on how you set it up. Yes, the search works across spaces by default. I think that you can configure the search to be a bit more specific if you'd like.
Okay, another question is there a duplicate or clone feature to initially set up sections or subspaces that can span multiple spaces?
So there is a concept of templates in Open Atrium where you can create a template for a subsection, for a section or for a subspace, and then be able to use that same template across, you know, multiple times. But there is not currently a clone feature.
Okay, we have some longer questions I think we should keep for the end.
Okay, that sounds great. So let's move on to the did I do it right section. There is no single right way to do this. The question about whether you did it right depends on whether or not this site works for you and your organization and your team. So we really recommend testing it out. So once you have sort of come up with a structure that you think will work, create users and spaces and sections according to your plan, and then add some content to those spaces and sections. So create some content that you want all users to see. Create some content that you only want a specific group of users to see. Create some content that requires approval. Create some content for specific projects and spaces and sections. And then also log in, create users and log in as somebody else with somebody else's permissions. And then we're going to ask yourself some red flag questions and know how to mitigate some of the circumstances that may come up. So ready for some red flag questions. First one, am I creating duplicate content or putting the same content in multiple spaces? Ask yourself this. If you are creating duplicate content, you may try to make a space specifically for that function or need, or you might give access to the people from each of those, spaces or each of those groups who need that functionality. So if you're creating duplicate content, that's a red flag and you want to see how you can mitigate that in your site structure. Do my users see irrelevant content when they log on? This is why I said log in as somebody else. If you log in as somebody else and you see a whole bunch of stuff that you don't need, they probably don't have quite the right permissions or subscriptions to spaces set up, or you may need to consider subdividing your content a little bit more and making a little bit more specific to different folks in order for them to not have irrelevant content when they log on. Do I have to move any content to a different space to get it approved? Excuse me. If so, your workflow might be off a little bit. Consider adjusting your space memberships or making a different section for content that needs a specific group of people working on it, and create a team to work on that section. Is my post reaching everyone who needs to see it? If not, you may need to change permissions or get some people subscribed to a space or create a space specifically for that need or collaboration. And did anyone see this content that wasn't supposed to? Vitally important. Definitely you want to test this out first and make sure that you have the privacy settings correct on all of your spaces. So your permissions and your privacy settings are probably off if somebody saw content that wasn't supposed to. Make sure the right groups are members of the space or create a special team for a specific purpose when you need to. And those are kind of our big red flag questions. You can come up with a whole bunch of others specific to your organization as well. But those are kind of the big ones. So if you're ready, if you've got this all down, you're super excited, you've already dreamed up exactly how you want your spaces and your sections to go, and you're ready, here's what to do next. The new release, like I said, 2.09 is out today. You can find it at drupal.org, as I said. You can see more about the features and the use cases and understand a little bit more about what's in Open Atrium. If you're not quite ready to jump into the code, you can read a little bit more about it at openatrium.com. You can also link there to some other webinars and some other content about it. And you can also sign up for our newsletter list if you want to always be notified when a new release comes out, things like that. You can try it on Pantheon. This is super fast and easy. Highly recommend it. There's a button right on the front of openatrium.com that says try on Pantheon. Just click it and you'll be on your way to an Open Atrium site in about 5 minutes. It's very quick and very easy. And Pantheon's a great partner of ours on this. So you can, and it's free. So you can spin up an Open Atrium site, try it out, see what you think. Test out some concepts with your content and see if it's something that you might want to use. And then if you want to really dig into videos and documentation and relive this webinar in all its glory, you can do that at docs.openatrium.com. Assuming that our recording worked well, and we hope it did, we will be posting this webinar to that shortly there after this. And if you need help, that's understandable too. So, Open Atrium, again, it's open source. There's no vendor lock-in. Phase 2, as well as a lot of other shops, provide professional services around Open Atrium. We can provide things like a jumpstart training to help plan or use an Open Atrium site, a custom implementation of Open Atrium, a migration from another intranet or collaboration platform or an old Open Atrium 1 site. And to do that, just visit openatrium.com, or you can email us directly and we can talk about your project and what you might need and how we might be able to help you. Certainly, there are a lot of shops and organizations you can also talk to and developers in the Open Atrium community as well. And there is if you're a developer, there's a Open Atrium IRC channel as well if you're a developer looking for assistance. So that's all of my content, but we have about 15 minutes for questions, and it sounds like we have some questions queued up. So Annie, I'll let you fire away on those.
Okay. Is Work Tracker included in OA out of the box? You mentioned milestones. Does this sort of issue tracking require customization?
Great question. Yes, Open Atrium does include Work Tracker out of the box, thanks to some awesome contributions from the community. You can configure Work Tracker to work in a number of different ways, but Open Atrium does have Work Tracker right out of the box.
We have a question about revisions. How about revisions of the published or non-published content? Can I revert my changes from one revision to another version?
Yes. Okay, so great questions. Yes, you can revert. And there is some limited versioning support in Open Atrium out of the box. It is not going to be super robust, but there's limited versioning in Open Atrium out of the box.
This question's about email notifications. Okay. Can email notifications be selective to all groups, teams, etc.?
Yes, absolutely. Notifications are completely customizable. You can create email notifications for content to go to specific groups, specific teams, specific individuals.
This question is about moving content. How do you move content from a space or section to another?
So the way that you move it from one, the way that you move content is to go into the edit of that piece of content. And then you look at where it is located and where it is nested, and you can select and move it to a different parent. So it's all there. There's a section in the edit form that says parent, and you can just change it to a new parent, and that will move it.
This question is about integrating databases. Can I integrate my MySQL server database, or matter of fact, any other database to create reports or content?
The answer to that is yes, but not out of the box. You would have to do some customization and some configuration to make that work. I don't have a ton of information about that, but our technical lead on the project would have more information about that.
Here's a question. Is there a plan to write a book for OA2?
There is not currently a plan to write a book for OA2, but we have written almost a book's worth of content on the documentation site, if you'd like to find it there.
How would you imagine or organize a peer reviewing platform using Open Atrium?
A peer reviewing platform. That's a really good question. I would want to know a lot more about what the need is and how that would be used. A peer reviewing platform could be done through some of the discussion functionality and the document sharing functionality, and you could actually create peer review teams, ad hoc teams that are made up of, you know, two peers to participate in that would be members of a restricted section. So just those peers would be able to see that discussion or those documents or specific to that peer review. So I think I would use the team functionality primarily on that. On a peer review concept, but you could create those, you know, peer review sections for, and then have teams assigned to them.
Okay, here's a question about changing the look of the site. What are the basic steps for changing the look of an Open Atrium site?
So there is there's some good tutorials on this. In order to show you, it would be a lot easier to show you, and I don't have an Open Atrium site set up. But if you go to docs.openatrium.com and you go through the tour, there are tour options for layouts and for the colorizer and for the panelizer and the widgets. So those are the three main ways you would do it, is through changing the layouts, through Panoply, adding widgets, and that allows you to add content and functionality directly to pages of your site. And then you can use the colorizer and change out the logo and things like that. And that's in the admin through the look and feel. But there's good tutorials on all of that in the tool, as well as on the doc site.
Okay, great. I have a longer question about publishing workflow.
Okay.
Could you explain what spaces/sections/groups/teams you would imagine for, this is also for a peer reviewing purpose. So the author would send to peer reviewers that makes comments on the content, then if peer reviewers approve the content, a publisher would release the content to the public.
Yeah, so, you know, you can certainly have roles, you know, like we talked about, there are roles in Open Atrium where certain people can publish content, and that you can, there isn't a, you know, submit this document for approval kind of workflow out of the box in Open Atrium, but you can certainly build one. But you can have people with permissions to publish content, and people with permissions to write content. But there isn't currently a full submission workflow out of the box in Open Atrium. That's something that could certainly be integrated or created, but because every organization does workflow a little bit differently, that doesn't come out of the box in the tool.
Here's the question. Will an update to Core Atrium change custom layouts each time?
I don't think so. I don't think so. But I don't know the answer to that for sure. So I can get back to you on that one.
Um, Can you have customized lists like SharePoint does in Open Atrium?
Right now, the list functionality that SharePoint has doesn't have an exact parallel in the Open Atrium. You can create lists of documents or of things that are in your site, but there isn't a specific list content type or list functionality that SharePoint has. Not yet, anyway.
Okay, great. Does Open Atrium support third-party web services or APIs like Google Analytics or Google Search?
Yeah, great question. Yes, the answer is yes. So integrations are really, really robust. The way the integrations work for Open Atrium is pretty exciting. So Open Atrium is Drupal. It's pure Drupal. So any module that is created for Drupal can be used in Open Atrium as long as it is configured and installed properly. So if there isn't a specific Open Atrium API, but Open Atrium plays really nicely with any Drupal module that you create that works with those services APIs, for one. And then the other thing is that because of the way Open Atrium is built and because of the flexibility and the widget mentality in Open Atrium, you can then really easily add views of content to your Open Atrium site very simply. So once there's a view, you know, such as a list of documents from Google Drive or, a list of discussion from a communication platform, you can actually create that view and then add it as a widget right into your Open Atrium site to any page and any space that you want. And that's where Open Atrium's flexibility comes in really handy. You don't have to break the structure or the system of Open Atrium to add those integrations directly into your spaces and sections. They work as widgets right in your spaces and sections. You would just create them. Those integrations would be created by creating a Drupal module that works with that services API.
All right, we have a question about messaging between users.
Okay.
Is the messaging limited to discussion sections and email notifications at the moment?
It is.
Okay.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
And do you think it's likely that a direct messaging module will be created in the future?
Yes and yes. It is limited currently to discussion forums and email as of now. I absolutely believe that there will be a direct messaging feature in the future. It's something that many users as well as some of our clients are looking for as well. And if anybody wants to help with that, you know, please feel free to let us know. It is open source after all.
Here's a question about spaces. Is it okay to have a space be a subspace of multiple spaces?
Hold on, I have to think about that for a second while my mind is blown. Hold on. Is it possible for a space to be a subspace of multiple spaces? Yes. The answer is yes. There is the option of having kind of a matrixed hierarchy in Open Atrium, which I didn't get into today because it's a little bit complex, but it is possible to have multiple parents for a subspace. Any more, Annie?
There's a few very specific questions, and I think the Open Atrium issue queue might be the best place for some of them.
Okay. Yeah. And if you have direct, you know, bugs or issues to report on Open Atrium, please do use the Open Atrium issue queue, which is at drupal.org and then /projects/Open Atrium. There's an issue queue where you can report any bugs or problems there. If you have specific, you know, if your developers have specific questions about using Open Atrium or getting it installed or configured or any of those things, the IRC channel is available in Open Atrium as well if you can't find the answers in documentation. And then, oh, and the issue queue is at project and then /issues/OpenAtrium, but you can get to it from the project page as well. But yeah, if you have specific bugs or issues to report on OpenAtrium, please do report them to that issue queue. That's the fastest and best way for them to get addressed. So that seems like that may be all of the questions for today. Thank you so much for attending and for all of your excellent questions. We will post this webinar and the recording of it as soon as we can. And please feel free to email us or drop us a line if you have further questions or want to talk further about your site. Thanks so much.